In the interest of time and to keep everybody on track here, I think we're going to get started. So if you could all take your seats, we will get going. So welcome to day two of the National Security Conference. My name is Michael Mosser. I'm the moderator for the panel. I have no official role in the conference beyond this, so I'm not going to talk anymore. You can find out who I am in the bios. The more important thing is who we've got up here on the dais. So I guess I'm standing to do this. I'm going to start on the far right and work my way to my left with Michael Vickers, former Undersecretary of Defense for Intelligence. And this is going to be an overview of these folks' bios. Again, their bios are in your pamphlets, and there's a lot more that I could say about this. But Mike Vickers was the Undersecretary of Defense for Intelligence, the Chief Executive Officer of the Defense Intelligence Enterprise, which at its height was 180,000 people that he oversaw. And from 2007 to 2011, he was the first and only Assistant Secretary of Defense for Special Operations, low-intensity conflict, and interdependent capabilities. And he oversaw pretty much everything that you would expect in there, everything from NSA to cyber to missile defense to our nuclear forces. Mike has a PhD from Johns Hopkins and is here in his capacity to speak to us on stability operations. Next to him, Kathleen Hicks, Senior VP, the Henry Kissinger Chair and Director of the International Security Program at CSIS, the Center for Strategic and International Studies. She was 2009 to 2013 the senior civilian official in the Department of Defense. In 2012, she was the principal deputy undersecretary of defense for policy, responsible for advising the Secretary of Defense on global and regional defense policy and strategy. She has a broad range of work at CSIS, a lot of which you can find online, and has her PhD in political science from MIT. Next to Kath is Colonel retired Pete Mansoor, the General Raymond E. Mason Jr. Chair of Military History at The Ohio State University. Go Buckeyes, right? So he is an academic now, but beforehand was served 26 years in the U.S. Army, culminating in his service as the Executive Officer to General David Petraeus, Commanding General of Multinational Force Iraq. Dr. Mansoor was the founding director of the U.S. Army Marine Corps Counterinsurgency Center at Fort Leavenworth and is the author of a number of books, including the most recent one, which you can find on the table outside, Surge, My Journey with General David Petraeus and the Remaking of the Iraq War, which is highly regarded in the field of military studies. Next to Colonel Mansoor is Paul Miller, the associate director of the Clements Center, a lecturer at the LBJ School of Public Affairs, former director for Afghanistan and Pakistan on the National Security Council, an intelligence analyst for CIA, and a military intelligence officer in the U.S. Army back in 2007. Paul is also a scholar, is a colleague of mine. We work together here at UT and is right now, he's got a book. Paul's also got a book. It's right there in front of all of us, but I'm sort of not standing there, but it's also on the table out there, Armed State Building. Yeah, there you go. Grab it. Show it off. Well done. Cornell University Press, 2013, available for purchase at the book table. Paul's got his PhD in international relations from Georgetown, and so we've got a great lineup here for you to talk about stability operations, about failed states, about sort of the problem of ungoverned spaces. My role as moderator, Rob Moser last night, if you were here, set the tone for our moderators. I'm going to stop talking. I'm going to allow our panelists up to 12 minutes each to give you their take on this very important problem for national security. After which, I will ask the first question, chair's prerogative sort of thing, and try to get the discussion going. We'll open it up to you for that same free-form discussion that we had yesterday. So with that, and no further ado, we'll start off with Michael Vickers, please.
Thank you, and good morning, everybody. So first, let me talk a little bit about what stability operations are. And as the name implies, you know, it's to bring stability to an area that has a lot of instability, but a key component is that there's some opposing force of some kind. So it can be after a conflict, as in the case of the invasions of Iraq and Afghanistan, where the conflict still continues against the remnants, and you're trying to bring stability. It's very much synonymous in a lot of cases with counterinsurgency operations. Or it can be independent, where you have state collapse. You don't invade the place, but you know, you have to, it's important enough in American interest that you have to do something about it. You know, as Condi Rice famously said, in 2002, national security strategy, the first one of the Bush administration, you know, we're threatened as much in a post 9/11 world by the weakness of states, ungoverned areas and others in certain areas, as we are by the strength of some states. Stability operations has probably been the area that has vexed us most, honestly, across the last couple of administrations in terms of finding the right formula to achieve our lasting ends. Over time, our military has become very, very good tactically at stability operations, but enduring effects, as you can see from looking around the world, have been very elusive. If you look at Iraq and Afghanistan, there are basically four lines of effort that we've done militarily, and they've all been fairly successful. The first is population security operations done by our conventional forces. Did a lot of that in Iraq, and with the surge in Afghanistan, did a lot of that there as well. Pete Mansoor is really an expert in that sort of thing. Did a masterful job in Baghdad in particular, and around Iraq. And the design there is to protect the bulk of the population and push out security as much as possible. Special operations loom very large in modern-day stability operations. We do a lot of raids. You know, in Afghanistan, at one point, we were doing, I think, 30 raids a night. Bill McRaven, my good friend, is going to be a speaker at lunch. He led a lot of that effort to try to take down the infrastructure. Modern-day insurgents, at least the kinds we faced in Afghanistan and Iraq, are not, they're more elusive in certain respects. It's more of a manhunting kind of game, and the special operations are very important. The third line of effort is harnessing local forces for tribal engagement. That was, of course, critical in Iraq, in Anbar. It also played a pretty big role in Afghanistan. We had a program called the Afghan Local Police that pound for pound really did more to hurt the Taliban, deny them territory in rural areas than a lot of the other forces or lines of effort we had. And then the fourth, and really the most important of all, is building up local security forces. There it's been a mixed bag across the region. But if you're going to transition and get out of the business of population security and other things, you have to succeed at that. And then, of course, there's a whole host I won't talk about. Others may wish to on the civilian side for development, and others that all must work together to make this work. So what's gone wrong? Well, you know, as Clausewitz famously said, war is a continuation of politics by other means, and that's even more true in insurgencies. It's intensely political. And if you don't get the politics right, it's going to be hard to get anything else right, no matter how tactically masterful you are. That's certainly the case in Iraq, and, you know, former prime minister named Nouri al-Maliki who said, thanks very much for putting me in power. Thanks very much for bringing security and stability to this place. I'd like the keys to the car now. Thank you very much. And then proceeded to drive it into the biggest ditch he could find. And, you know, so it's, again, a lesson about the challenges of enduring effects despite massive effort. In Afghanistan, Pete asked me a question before the panel started about Afghanistan in the 1980s, and is there anything we could have done at the end of the Cold War? Good friend of mine, Charlie Wilson, Texan, used some colorful language about we won the war and lost the peace. He didn't quite exactly say it that way, but and it's true. Now, our options were a little limited because our relations with Pakistan were strained at the time, but you have to win the peace. Afghanistan post 9/11 made a couple different mistakes. One, for a while, we really under-resourced the effort. Afghanistan is the size of Texas, we were trying to build a very, very small central army in Afghanistan that couldn't possibly control the territory, and over time, the insurgency became worse and worse. As we adapted in 2008, 9, 10, and had a big surge of forces, we did much better. The question is whether it was not enough of a period of time or too late. But the fundamental problem in Afghanistan is the insurgents have a sanctuary in Pakistan. And as long as you have that, it's tough to win. It's one of the sort of core things of counterinsurgency operations that makes those wars protracted. We've tried a lot of other things. In Libya, toppled the government and then basically didn't do very much about it. That hasn't been a very happy story. In Somalia, we've used multinational forces, African Union and others. They've done a pretty good job of pushing out from the capital, but by no means have we brought stability to Somalia. In Mali, which is in the news this morning, we had pretty modest capability development efforts, and Al-Qaeda and the Islamic Maghreb and a host of a bunch of groups took over the whole north, and French had to intervene and put the place back. So we've tried a number of different things, and again, with really struggling success. So the last point I'd like to make is that stability operations, particularly the high-octane ones that we've done in Iraq and Afghanistan, are really force structure intensive, and Kath can talk about this in more detail. There's some formulas that you need. One security official, both international and host nation, for every 50 of the population. That gets into some pretty big numbers when you get a population of 20, 30 million that you're trying to bring security to, or other ratios of 10 counterinsurgents for every one insurgent, but those are just rules of thumb. The bottom line is these wars last a long, long time. Afghanistan is already the longest war in our history, and as I said, it's something you have to maintain a capability to do, because there's failed states that certainly threaten our interests, but if you scale up beyond the countries of 20 or 30 million and imagine problems in Pakistan or Indonesia where you've got 200 million people, you have got just a daunting, daunting problem. So with that, I'll turn it over to the next speaker.
Great, thanks and to Mike, and thanks for inviting me here to Austin. I want to talk a little bit today, building a lot off of what Mike has brought to you, about the, if you will, the political military dynamics of stability operations. First, what exactly are stability operations? I think Mike gave you a very good, easy, quick rule of thumb way of thinking about them. There is an official definition, and the official definition is various military missions, tasks, and activities conducted outside the United States in coordination with other instruments of national power to maintain or reestablish a safe and secure environment, provide essential government services, emergency infrastructure reconstruction, and humanitarian relief. It's a very broad definition. The term that we've used, the stability operations term, is sort of the 2005 and following era, but it has many precursors, and indeed throughout history, the United States has been involved itself in stability operations, and the history of warfare has always included what falls into this category that I've just defined to you as stability operations. One study of the U.S. Army, as an example, indicated that there had been 11, what we might think of as wars, not all official, that the U.S. Army had been involved in since the founding of the Republic. But at the same time, there had been, by this definition, several hundred, although I think they included domestic engagement, several hundred stability operations that have occurred over the same period of time. So stability operations is a much more frequent kind of activity that the United States finds itself engaged in, especially if you're thinking across the span of humanitarian relief, all the way to these large-scale, long-duration operations such as we've had in Iraq and Afghanistan. And, you know, warfare is not necessarily, all the tenets of warfare are not necessarily immutable. This can change over time. But there's really been no indication, and I think Mike pointed to a few examples, that this requirement that has existed to create stability either as an expression of our humanitarian values or as a necessary step in achieving security, including in the follow-on to military conflict, that that's really fundamentally changed. So it's still with us in the environment. But what has changed and has changed, waxed and waned throughout history, and certainly for the United States, is the tolerance that the American public and its leadership has for exercising its selective engagement national strategy approach through stability operations. What has also waxed and waned quite clearly is the degree to which the U.S. military, and a lot of this does fall primarily on the U.S. Army, but the U.S. military writ large has itself adopted the lessons learned and adjusted to this reality of continuing requirements for stability operations. Probably the most prominent recent example of this shift in political interest was in early 2012 when the Obama administration, in its articulation of its defense strategy, determined that the United States would no longer size forces for large-scale, long-duration, actually use the term prolonged, stability operations. So the translation is, in the modern vernacular, if it was in the 1970s through the 1990s, no more Vietnams, as President Bush had, first President Bush said. Today it is no more Iraqs, or certainly in 2012 it was no more Iraqs. Instead, what the Defense Department put forward and again signed off on by the President and really driven by the White House was that the United States did need, even though it wasn't going to size this, to retain the skills and capabilities across the U.S. government in order to execute stability operations. So just taking a quote from that to make this clear, the statement is, in the aftermath of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, the United States will emphasize non-military means and military-to-military cooperation to address instability and reduce the demand for significant U.S. force commitments to stability operations. So fast forward to today. This is the policy, essentially, that you are seeing play out in various portions of the world. We obviously have had very vivid examples in Libya and now Iraq and Syria, where there is this question about whether there should be a significant stability operation undertaken. And it plays out really at the political level in terms of what the American public deems as being most important to its interests. What I would like to do now is sort of jump past, if you will allow it, jump past the immediate crisis, political crisis about how we think about the use of force, to just look at the span of history behind us and look to the future. And join me in the assumption that at some point, somewhere, some political official along the way is going to decide that U.S. interests are engaged sufficiently that the United States will engage again in a stability operation. It's this leap that I think is extremely important for thinking through the institutional demand for the United States on the civilian and military side to have the capability, the wherewithal, which can include capacity issues, to execute those kinds of operations. So at this particular point in time, we're not sure this is, we have identified a time and a place where this makes sense now, but given our history, chances are very strong something will happen in the future, even if it's a major humanitarian mission that will drive us to have to execute stability operations again. So what needs to be done to make sure that that can be done well? And this will, in many ways, echo what Mike has said. The first thing is that there are a very specific set of skill sets that are going to be important to any kind of stability operation to be executed in the future. Every one of these kinds of operations is joint, meaning it's across the military services. It's international or multinational, most likely through a coalition effort as opposed to a formal, for instance, NATO mission or even UN mission. And it's a whole of government, meaning it's civilian and military working together. So the good news about that is that that's the same skill set we need for basically any kind of military operation in the future. You really can't imagine, it'd be very hard to imagine a military operation that didn't have that complexity to it. So that's something we should already be training to and developing leadership skills for. Also good news, in a slightly perverse ways. We've had 15 years of experience and counting, it's still going, intense experience working in that kind of environment. So we have an entire generation or two of civilian and military officials and junior officers, NCOs, who have grown up through their career operating in that kind of environment. So in some ways you can rest on the laurels a little bit, even where there's not a political interest in pursuing these kinds of activities. The bad news is the history that we have always had, which is it's very easy and culturally comfortable for everyone to fall back into their stovepipes if allowed to do so and not operate this way. The current strategy for countering ISIS is an example. I was mentioning this to Mike before our session. I had one senior official from the administration say to me recently, there are 9 lines of effort, that's factually true, for the strategy to counter ISIL, but there's no one below the level of the National Security Advisor who actually has the function of integrating those lines of effort. So, for instance, you have the military in charge of several, you have the State Department in charge of some, you probably have Treasury in charge of some, and the integration is sort of, left to chance and hope, if not managed day in, day out by the National Security Advisor and the President. So that's a very natural way for our government to fall back into stovepipes, and it's a problem for any kind of stability operation you'd want to do in the future. Second is there really has to be an emphasis, given this reality that we will end up in these kind of complex operations in the future, to build civilian capability and capacity. The State Department, by its nature, by its culture, is not an operational organization. It's a diplomatic organization. That's not an indictment, that's a fact. That's the world in which the State Department lives and that which they value the most, just as DOD is operational in nature and values operational capability the most. The problem has been how you build operational capability for stability operations on the civilian side within the State Department. I don't have an answer to you for that. USAID faces, which is a development operational agency, or can be an operational agency, and the Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance, for instance. These are operational entities that do reside in the State Department. And maybe give us some models for how best to ensure there is a incentive structure to grow those kinds of civilian capabilities. But that's going to take a very hard look at how do we best institutionalize civilian capability and capacity. That has been an effort for over 10 years, and it has basically failed. And it's not because there aren't great civilians. It's because the emphasis, those who kind of go into this line of work, for instance, justice reform, institution building, local governance, they are not the people who tend to rise to the top of the State Department. So that's an institutional challenge that we have on the civilian side. Third, I think the military on the military side needs to view the concept of stability operations much more broadly than we have come to and understand that it's highly applicable, even if at least as a partial framework, to almost any operation we can imagine. So the skill sets that you need, the breadth across the force of language capability, the cultural awareness and capacity, the ability to operate in a dispersed manner, and maintain communication and command in that kind of dispersed environment. The ability to shape the information environment along with civilian officials, or at least keep up with the information environment. That might be a nice first step. The ability to decipher networks and understand, as Mike said, the local actors' roles and responsibilities and influence. These are all skill sets that we need to make sure the military maintains, even if we're not going to be sized for these prolonged large-scale operations. Mike rightly pointed to Special Operations Forces as having many of these skill sets, and they are appropriate to be used at the high end of many of these missions and in some specific portions of these missions, but they are not in and of themselves a solution set for the challenge of stability operations. They rely, for one thing, very much on for sustaining themselves on the Army and other services. And they aren't sized, nor do we want them sized, because they are special for use in these large-scale operations. So there is and for things like humanitarian assistance. So there is a challenge here in how we maintain the skill sets that we need beyond special operations. So let me just close by saying, my view is if the question to the panel is what is the future of stability operations, it's stability operations has a future. It's going to change in its nature, just as it always has, but its basic tenet of having to operate in a political military environment in which security and stability on the social and political side are intertwined will remain with us.
Well, thanks, Kathleen. Thank you all for being here this morning. Thanks to the Strauss Center for inviting me, my first time at the University of Texas, and it's an enjoyable time being here. I can tell you a little tale. A military force deploys across the ocean. It lands, conducts a fairly brief, at times bitter fight to destroy an enemy army. It seizes the enemy's capital, at which time it immediately finds itself trying to rebuild the government, create order from chaos, and fighting a burgeoning guerrilla campaign. Now, you might think I'm talking about Iraq, but this is actually taken out of a history of the U.S. invasion of Mexico in 1847. Talk to you about another tale. A military force engages in a prolonged and bitter guerrilla conflict, learns a lot of things from it, but decides that that's the only kind of conflict of its sort that it's going to ever fight. And so it deliberately chooses not to write down the lessons or create doctrine. And within a decade, it finds itself in another land conducting a very bitter guerrilla campaign, which it ultimately wins, but at great cost. Now you may think I'm talking about Iraq as well, but no, that's the transition from the Indian Wars to the Philippine War in the latter part of the 19th century. What I'm trying to get at is stability operations are not new. They are a recurring theme throughout American military history. I think Kathleen laid that out pretty nicely with the numbers. And they're the kind of operation that American military forces and policymakers love to hate. And why is that? Well, the end states are often unclear. Other than we want stability, what is it that we want? And this gets to Mike's point that the political end state and getting the politics right is always the number one task, but it's always the hardest task. And so we don't necessarily always tackle that first. And so we end up in these sort of murky wars, murky operations that drag on and on and on, and the interminable timelines associated with them. When are they going to end? Give me the plan to finish it. You know, George C. Marshall once famously said, Americans will not fight a 7 years war. Well, we've proved him wrong, right?
Twice.
Yeah. And the steady drip, drip, drip of casualties. Americans are not casualty averse. If we're on a path to victory, they will suffer 460,000 dead as they did in World War II in order to finish the conflict. It's the steady drip, drip, drip that has no end in sight that they object to. And finally, stability operations are a resource sink. We spent upwards of $1 trillion in the Iraq War for very little gain. Afghanistan is a resource sink that continues to suck money out of the United States, and the American people obviously don't like this either. Neither do I, being an American citizen. But like a party goer with a hangover who swears off booze, we will swear off stability operations until we are inevitably dragged into one again by necessity. And why is this? Well, simply put, how are wars won? Is military victory alone sufficient? Well, let's look at a couple of examples. Now, you might think the Civil War, which was one of the most decisive wars in American history, was a war that we won. And in the sense that the Union remained together, we did win it. But in fact, the other goal, to make sure that all American citizens, because African Americans were now American citizens, were treated equally and equitably, and that the South was followed through with the various constitutional amendments that were enacted in the wake of the Civil War, that we definitively lost. We lost it for 100 years. And we lost it because of the insufficient resources applied to stability operations during Reconstruction. And we got the politics wrong there, too, by the way. And it led to what my colleague Mark Grimsley says is a 100-year insurgency that finally, you know, you could say it was won during the civil rights movement in the 1960s, but given what's happening in Ferguson and other places in the United States, you know, we are still suffering the aftermath of that. Another example, World War I. We definitively defeated the German army, right? Well, we didn't stay there. We didn't occupy Germany. We did for a very brief time. We didn't continue to be involved in European affairs. We sort of retreated into our shell, saying we're happy that's over now and they can take care of themselves. And the result was, as we know, the growth of a movement in Germany which blamed their defeat on communists, socialists, and Jews, the famous stab in the back legend, and eventually the rise of the Nazi Party. So where have we won? I'll give you a few examples there, too. The Philippines. I would mark that down in the victory camp, but it was almost a half a century of occupation of that land, and eventually we got the politics right. We promised them their independence in 1936, which is why the Filipinos were highly supportive of U.S. military operations during World War II and fought probably one of the most successful guerrilla campaigns in World War II, rivaling Tito's guerrilla operations in Yugoslavia with U.S. support. So you get the politics right, it can show you that an American presence overseas isn't necessarily toxic. Germany and Japan, well-known examples, we're still there today in both places. Korea, we're still there with U.S. forces. And it's not like Americans are clamoring for the troops to come home from these places. The fact is that if you don't have the steady drip, drip, drip of casualties and the politics are right, Americans will support long-term overseas presence. Afghanistan's a do-out. It depends whether we're going to stay there or not. And you know, there's a lot of history yet to be written in that conflict. So I would argue that stability operations are essential to victory in war in just about any way you define it. Very few examples of war where we just went in, kicked butt, and left, and then had a good outcome. The wars of 9/11 have shown the difficulty of industrial-scale prolonged stability operations in the heart of the Islamic world. At least in this part of the world for the foreseeable future, I think the future of stability operations are a much more modest and carefully crafted sort with much, much more modest goals. I don't think that means we need to swear off the use of military force in the Islamic world. In fact, I'm on record publicly saying we should have a NATO-led ground operation to destroy the Islamic State. And we can talk about what the aftermath of that would look like, because the president came out and said, well, those who say that, you know, they're not looking at what's going to follow those operations. Well, we have. It's just that, you know, he doesn't want to necessarily acknowledge that there are other solutions to the issue. Forces, as Kathleen said, will no longer be sized for prolonged stability operations, but the brain power of our military and civilian policymakers can be right-sized to understand them. And this is what needs to happen as time goes on here, because we're going to get away from stability operations. The American people hate them. We're in the downward curve of this sine wave. But when the time comes to recreate the capabilities that can enact stability operations, we should not also have to recreate the thinking that goes into their creation. And although all of government approach works best, the fact is that most of the capabilities for stability operations will be drawn from the military. They can be ordered to deploy, and civilians cannot. And that's especially into conflict zones, and it's as simple as that. Emma Skye, I'll leave you with her quote from her great book, The Unraveling. There's no magical or mythical corps of civilian advisors that can be parachuted into foreign lands to help fight America's wars. And with that, I will turn it over to the next panelist. Thank you.
Thank you, Pete, and thank you to our panelists for a great discussion so far. I appreciate you guys being here in Austin. There's a joke going around that you may have heard or read elsewhere In Iraq, we invaded and occupied, and the result was a costly failure. In Libya, we invaded and did not occupy, and the result was a costly failure. And in Syria, we have neither invaded nor occupied, and the result is a costly failure. I've heard this now three or four different places. I did not make that up. It's a witty, a pithy way of capturing the frustration that a lot of American policymakers feel about the foreign policy choices they have before them. I actually think it's kind of an unhelpful way of thinking about the future of stability operations. It's unhelpful because it's fatalistic, as if there's nothing that we can do right and nothing that we have ever done right. It's unhelpful because it is there's a historical amnesia there, as if history started in 2003 and we only have three cases of intervention or non-intervention to learn from. Of course, history goes way back much further than that, as Pete, you mentioned. And it's unhelpful because it's reductionistic. It treats as if invading and occupying are the only two variables that matter and they're binary variables. Of course, there's a lot more choices that go into interventions. There's a more accurate narrative. It's less witty, but it would say something like this, that in Iraq we invaded and occupied badly, and then I think withdrew prematurely, and that's why the result was a costly failure. In Libya, we overthrew and then did not mount any kind of reconstruction and stabilization operation at all, which is why it was a costly failure. And in Syria, I would say we've just sort of lost our political nerve altogether. So none of these three cases are good test cases for the principle of intervention. If you want a good test case, you have to intervene well, according to the book, and then fail. That would be a good test case for the principle of intervention and the principle of stability operations, and we haven't seen a case like that. I'd also add, I think Afghanistan is not a good case, a test case, because of the resource constraints and because of the deadlines as well. So how do we think about the future of stability operations? Well, we can start by reminding ourselves of some of the history here. Since the end of the Cold War, the United States and the United Nations have mounted, by my count, about 28 interventions. These are peace enforcement missions, post-conflict, reconstruction, stabilization, stability operations. Every bureaucracy's got its own name for these things, but they all refer to the same thing. There's a widespread perception that we're bad at it, that we fail more often than we succeed, and that was true. But again, by my count, we actually are getting better. I think our success rate's grown from 48 to 57% in recent years. So we actually are getting better at these operations. We're knowing how to do them better. Nonetheless, we mount them less frequently. Since 2011, we've only got two, I think. Mali and the Central African Republic are some new UN missions. Notably, there are glaring cases of non-intervention. Of course, Syria is the big one. And I count Libya as well. I think if Syria and Libya had happened 15 years ago, absolutely, the United Nations, maybe NATO, would be in both of those countries with large-scale stability operations. I think what's happened is what used to be called the Vietnam syndrome, what I would call the brief Somalia fallacy, and then the Iraq syndrome. The belief that interventions are inevitably more costly than they're worth, and the likelihood of success is too low to justify intervention. There's a widespread belief that the costs are always too high and the chances of success are always too low. And I think that's a pretty clear case of overgeneralizing from cherry-picked evidence, from one case, Iraq, or one case, Somalia. In the 1990s, every single time we talked about intervening somewhere, somebody would trot out the Battle of Mogadishu and say, well, this is going to happen again, as if that was a blueprint that all interventions inevitably followed. And now today, the same is true of Iraq. We talk about Syria, and inevitably, somebody immediately talks about Iraq. We can't possibly send in another 100,000 troops for a ground war in the heart of the Middle East. Well, there are other options. The silver lining is that in the last few years, we have now seen the cost of not intervening, which is actually kind of new. For 25 years, we've seen the cost of intervening. They are expensive. They are hard. They require lots of troops, lots of money, lots of time and patience, which politicians aren't known for having. And they're difficult, and they do fail quite a lot. But now we've seen very clear evidence of the cost of not intervening and not mounting a stability operation. We've seen the cost in Syria, of course, in Afghanistan, in Yemen, in the Congo, in elsewhere in Iraq. What we see, I think we can make the argument two ways, by looking at the data and by looking at the theory. I think what we've seen recently is that the sort of counterterrorism only approach, where you just assassinate terrorist leaders and leave the politics to work itself out, only leads to forever war. There's a never-ending cycle of political violence. Maybe it keeps us safe in a rudimentary sense, but it solves no problems. There is no end to political violence today in any of these regions. The regions where we have simply not tried a stability operation, or the regions where we've tried a sort of a light footprint stability operation, there's simply no end to political violence, and therefore there's no end to the threats that emanate from these areas that could threaten American national security interests. You can make the same case in theory. As Clausewitz said, war is about, it aims at a political end. The counterterrorism-only strategy has no political endpoint. It has no political goal that it's aiming at. All it aims at is killing bad guys with nothing else, you're not even trying for anything else. You can make the same argument by just war theory. War aims at peace. CT only aims at no peace. It only aims at killing bad guys. By the data, by looking at the experience in Iraq and Syria and Afghanistan and elsewhere, we see that there's no end to violence and no end to threats. Or in theory, we understand why that's the case. If we don't try to aim at stability or peace, we're not going to get it. So I say that's a kind of a silver lining because I think it's a helpful learning point. It's a helpful moment of learning. We are understanding again the importance of careful, moderated interventions when called for. I think, Pete, you kind of hinted at this. The future of stability operations is fewer but better. Fewer but better. We will continue to do stability operations, but we'll be more selective in choosing when to do them, and I think we probably will be more savvy about how we do them. In seeking to recalibrate our approach to stability operations, some of the lessons that we'll take, what are the lessons that we'll take? Well, the lesson is not always intervene, and the lesson is not never intervene. And that seems to be the public debate these days, always go, never go. I think rather the lesson is to undertake a tailored approach to match our resources to the conditions of state failure on the ground. That means there is no cookie cutter. There is no real doctrine of stability operations, or the doctrine would say, study the country you're intervening in and then match your resources to what's going on in that country. So we can't just take a model of success, like West Germany, and say, we did X, Y, and Z, therefore we should do the exact same thing in Syria or North Korea. Sadly, that's not the case. It's going to be a bit more intellectually difficult, and why it's a good idea for us to retain some of that learning capability that Pete talked about. I think that resources can't win. We can't guarantee victory, but the absence of resources can guarantee failure. I think that's one of the lessons we should take, particularly from the experience in Afghanistan. That means in the future stability operations, we should surge from day one. We shouldn't wait 5 years. We shouldn't wait 4, 5, 6 years before surging. It's important for us to go all in when we decide that we need to undertake a stability operation. I agree with Kath, we need a civilian capability, and here I'm a bit pessimistic because the efforts to build a civilian capacity, as Kath said, have failed. The civilian response corps in the State Department has been largely shut down. I think it's been now shunted aside into USAID as a very smaller version of itself, the civilian crisis response staff, I think it's called. The State Department's Office of Conflict and Stabilization Operations, its budget has been zeroed out in the 2016 budget request. So the institutions that we started to build over the past 15 years, we are now unbuilding. Despite the rhetoric of capturing the lessons, I think we're not doing a very good job of institutionalizing them. Similarly, with our forces no longer being sized for stability operations, I am concerned about our future ability to mount these operations when the next one comes. And make no mistake, it will come. I've heard critics and scholars say that we should not learn the lessons of stability operations because we simply will not wage them again. I think it takes a bit of chutzpah to decide in advance that we know every crisis and every war that we're going to fight in the indefinite future, and decide in advance that we will never need the tool of stability operations ever again. It's possible, but I think that's highly unlikely. I think it's much more likely that we will need the tool of stability operations for some contingency at some point in the future, and therefore it's prudent to remain prepared for that contingency. Some places will not be worth the cost. I think Yemen, I think Somalia, I think the Congo are not worth the cost that it would require for us to stabilize those places. But I think places like Afghanistan is definitely worth the cost. I think President Obama was right to leave a contingency force in Afghanistan past 2016. I think that contingency force is probably too small, and I think we have consistently underfunded governance and reconstruction efforts there for 14 years quite consistently. I think Syria is not a stability operation yet. I think it's a war, and I think if we undertake a stability operation in Syria, we must first be prepared to wage a war there and to defeat both the Islamic State and Assad, and then begin to contemplate what a stability operation would look like. But despite how complicated that sounds, I actually think the hardest and most difficult is North Korea. I think it is a near certainty that within our working lives, we will see the collapse of North Korea, either peacefully or by defeat in war, and the international community will then be compelled to mount the most ambitious reconstruction and stabilization operation that we've seen since West Germany. And I'm not very optimistic about how that will turn out. So.
With Chinese forces involved.
That's right. Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you all for some outstanding comments on a topic that is famously difficult to wrap your head around, let alone to compress into 9 minutes or 12 minutes or whatever it was that we had here. As I mentioned in the introductory remarks, chair's prerogative, I get to ask the first question. I'm an international security scholar, not necessarily a national security one, and so I want to approach this from the broad international relations perspective. And it'll actually tie into last night's panel. Those of you here last night heard also four really distinguished panelists give their perspective on the Russian threat. And a couple times in that panel, the idea came up of the threat to basically the underlying international order that Russia may itself pose. An existential threat, not so much to the United States anymore, but perhaps to the underlying order, and also some of these other actors who are posing similar threats. This ties into this panel in some really interesting ways. What about the international context of stability? We had a great series of discussions here about the American sort of role in stability and whether or not we actually consider stability to be in our national interests. But might not stability operations globally be important for essentially preserving the fabric of what we could, you know, sort of generically call the international liberal economic order, or the international order even more generically, in some ways, that this is beyond just the U.S. national interest, but rather something that is at the heart of it, kind of fundamental for the security challenges of the 21st century. So I'll just throw that out to anybody who'd like to.
Yeah, so I mean, borrowing from Henry Kissinger, I think we have three challenges to the international order. It really is a pretty unprecedented time: China and East Asia, Russia and Europe, and then sectarian conflict and global jihad emanating out of the Middle East. Particularly the global jihad part is the part that threatens the order, but the chaos makes it possible. And whether stability operations is a solution or not, you know, depends on a case-by-case basis. But if you look at, for instance, a lot of the Russian challenges, it's hybrid warfare. You know, it's unconventional warfare, and then conventional warfare is necessary when things aren't going their way. But if you lose that early unconventional phase, say in the Baltics or something, the idea that NATO would trigger Article 5 over subversion is, you know, probably wishful thinking. And so you've got to be prepared to, you know, that's the world we live in right now. And then certainly with the Middle East, you know, a lot of hope of American energy independence and a range of things, you know, whether, you know, we're interested in the Middle East is definitely interested in us, and global jihad will follow us. You know, as Paul rightly said, not every bit of chaos in the world is a threat to order or something we have to respond to, but the Middle East certainly will.
Let me add to that. I'll pick up particularly on Mike's theme about what he references hybrid warfare. Some people call it gray area, whatever your preferred term is. We certainly have a trend of it with China and with Russia. And Iran, and they each take different forms, but in many ways, if you turn the state weakness problem around, that weakness or that fragility that creates the dynamics that cause stability operations, if you will, or that drive us to stability operations, they can be organic to the country, or they can be induced, if you will. And what we are seeing, particularly with the Russians, and a lot of political subversion, plus cyber, plus information warfare, et cetera. By political subversion in particular, I mean funding of political parties in Europe that support a Russian agenda. When you look at all those factors, what they are doing is undermining the very stability of those countries politically and socially. And that is the same, that knocks you, if you will, into that same basket of things we often think of happening in more of a third world context as the source of a stability operation. So the way in which we think about stability operations, as I said, needs to really broaden. I think the form that it takes and the cause behind it may become much more purposeful from outside states as opposed to simply organic failures of countries such as we've seen most recently in Syria and Iraq. And the same skill sets that we can bring to bear, which really are that whole of government, a lot of civilian tools that aren't there. They're not there. And to the extent that they're there, they're not integrated, nor are the military tools integrated with them. And then the breadth of the military tools themselves need to take account of this changing landscape.
Well, I think the international community does have an interest in preserving the international liberal international order. And they will participate in stability operations to a point. First, this shows the importance of alliances to the United States. We have, since the end of the Cold War, tended to go it alone. Alliances have been usually window dressing, enacted more for political legitimacy than for the actual capabilities that they bring to the table. And in the future, I don't think that'll be the case. We're going to have to rely on international partners to actually bring capability to the table. But they will come with caveats. Various forces will operate with different rules of engagement. And just in Iraq alone, you had basically three types. The Brits, who were there in force and had almost no difference in their rules of engagement from ours, but there were actually some differences. For instance, their advisors couldn't accompany Iraqi formations into battle until the middle of the battle for Basra, and then they finally changed the policy. A second type would be like the Polish contingent, which I fought with in Karbala. They could do only defensive operations, but that still made them highly valuable to our operations, and we worked really closely with them. Welcome addition. And then there was a third type, the South Koreans or the Thais. There were a number of these kind of nations that could only do humanitarian operations, and if there was any hint of violence on the horizon, they would retreat into their forward operating bases. In general, I'd say there will be more international cooperation the less dangerous the scenario. And of course, this is not what we want. We want people who will, you know, follow us into Syria and help reconstruct the or you know, do stability operations in that country. And that's of course, it's a tall order for most countries. So. I think there will be a role to play for the international community, but we shouldn't overstate it.
We seem to have gravitated towards a kind of a implied division of labor, where the United States does the trigger pulling, and then we try to outsource the rest to the United Nations. That's what we certainly try to do in Afghanistan. I'm not convinced that's worked very well. It can work. So when I kind of dismissed, I said Yemen, the Somalia, Congo. I certainly would have no problem with the United Nations undertaking operations there and the United States lending support, because the United States does have some crucial capabilities in logistics, intelligence, airlift that we, I think, should lend to the United Nations for those marginal cases that aren't necessarily centrally important to U.S. national security but are very important to liberal order. And yes, the United States should support liberal order where possible, but we should do so in a cost-effective way where it's not central to our security interests.
Great, thank you. We can now open up to questions. We've got about 34 minutes or so left, so that's about five questions. We'll do what we did last night and kind of walk around. It looks like we've got folks in the middle. So we'll start here, and then we'll catch the wings as necessary. Sir.
Thank you. My name is Jeff Goodson. I worked for USAID for 29 years, did three deployments to Afghanistan. I'm kind of interested in this notion about the end of security operations, stability operations. It strikes me that this is one of those deals where you may be done with stability operations, but they're not going to be done with you. I know that in Afghanistan, we didn't just look at SO as one of the five elements of irregular warfare and something you set out to do, but it was the normal follow-on to the post-kinetic environment, humanitarian assistance quickly going into stability operations, which could be on a local level fairly short and sweet, but mostly not. I guess I'm most interested in what's going on right now with the debate over who's going to do this stuff going forward. You know, USAID effectively abdicated its responsibilities as the lead development agency in the defense development diplomacy national security paradigm. And it's a June 2015 policy statement about how it was going to deal with DOD. And the debate going on within DOD, at least with a lot of the military people having dealt with irregular warfare, is whether or not that DOD wants to be doing this at all. And they would much prefer to scrape it off to USAID and state. I think that this kind of has come home to roost here this week. There's an interesting story in Politico where it was reported that the senior brass was advising the president. One of the reasons they're advising him against putting boots on the ground in Syria was because of the inability of state and USAID to follow on the kinetics with what was required to bring about ultimate stability there. So I'd be interested in y'all's comments on that. Thank you.
Well, I have absolutely nothing to disagree with in your statement. I wish I had more to say than that. I think we are stuck. We have been stuck. I think at the beginning of the Obama administration, the end of the Bush administration into the beginning of the Obama administration, there really was energy around building civilian capacity and capability, and it didn't happen, and it got lost. And the history for me is not yet written on exactly what happened on the civilian side to make that happen. All the right decisions in terms of institution building on paper took place, and there's certainly been a lot of money. I don't want anyone to walk away with the view that we haven't put a lot of money into, for instance, Afghanistan reconstruction. The trouble is we haven't been terribly effective. I think this was the gist of Mike's remarks at the beginning. Sort of achieving the ends has been very difficult to do. The civil-military interaction is very complicated. It is a deep-seated belief in the military side that the civilians are never coming. Stated desire that matches the roles and responsibilities on paper, that it is not a primarily a military responsibility to do that follow-on work, again, governance work, justice building, those kinds of things, except in environments, as in the stability operations definition, where there is contested security and DOD has to have a larger role. But there is always envisioned a handoff because that is, in fact, how we are supposed to be operating as a U.S. government. But there is a deep-seated belief that the civilians are never coming, and it makes it very complicated to walk this line of, do we build capacity and capability in the Defense Department knowing that's going to happen, but in doing that, we remove any incentive for anyone else to build it. And that's why you sort of see this stalemated approach, I think, on both sides. I think, you know, I defer to those who've lived more on the civilian agency side, but I suspect it's a similar view that we want to be in charge. This is our mission, but we also know DOD's going to kind of do it, even though, and then we can, you know, we're not very happy about it, but we also can rely on that so we don't make it a priority for our investment.
Yeah, and I would just add, you know, if you look at USAID's capabilities in the 1960s, it was just dramatically, orders of magnitude, more capable as an agency than it has been, you know, post-Vietnam. I mean, one of the things, as Kath said, you know, is we've substituted capital and probably insufficient capital, but also capital can't be effective without that kind of labor. And in the 1960s, there was lots of labor. There's a lot of intellectual capital in the State Department. Some of it, you know, hopes were, you know, shattered, but there was tremendous capability that was just washed out of our civilian agencies, much as counterinsurgency was washed out of the military.
I would just say, from the military point of view, you know, you can wish it away, but military amnesia on whether they should do stability operations or not leads to failure time and again. Yeah. Iraq is a great point. You know, they didn't want to do it. Finally, ORHA has created the Office of Reconstruction and Humanitarian Affairs. It's created like 2 months before we begin the invasion of Iraq. Go back to World War II, General George C. Marshall created the military civil governments that would govern Germany in January or February of 1942, 3 years before we invaded the continent of Europe, 2 years before. So we've somehow lost the ability as an institution, the military, to realize that it's going to be our responsibility, whether we like it or not, at least initially, and to craft forces accordingly.
Those military government liaison teams that helped rebuild West Germany after the reconstruction changed their name, and they became known as civil affairs. So the military does actually have a reconstruction capability in the civil affairs component. Problem is, after Vietnam, I believe the Army moved civil affairs into the reserve component specifically so that they would not be called on to mount a large reconstruction or counterinsurgency without sort of whole of nation involvement. They wanted to make sure that the nation would be committed by putting the civil affairs in the reserve component where they'd be mobilized. I can see some advantage to that, but I also see how that, in my view, that sort of didn't happen in the last 15 years. So it may be time to move civil affairs back into the active component and just accept that the Army will lead, at least in the early phase, they will lead reconstruction operations. That may be one way forward.
You will go this direction first, and then, sir, and then we'll come back.
First of all, thank you very much, panel, for all the things that you've you brought out today. What I'd like to do is pose a hypothetical that's likely to occur, as was mentioned by Mr. Miller. Let's talk about the collapse of North Korea in, say, within a decade. And let's just pose a hypothetical that that the government is overthrown by internal revolution. Here's your chance right now to tell me and the audience here the top 3 to 5 things that you would propose that we do right now as a nation to prepare for that contingency. And I'll ask Ms. Hicks to start because...
I'll start.
Because I like what you said in the beginning.
Oh, okay, thanks. I'm very used to being voluntold for a variety of things. Number one thing I do actually is develop the Saberni counter chemical, biological, nuclear, radiological capability for the United States military, and also ensure capacity and capability on the part of the South Koreans, Republic of Korea. This is, by the way, daunting because Sam Locklear is sitting in the audience, so I'll let him check me on my priorities. But that would be the number one thing, because in a collapse scenario, the first thing we will worry about is we and the Chinese will be worrying about are those WMD facilities that are scattered all across North Korea and making sure they're secured. Second to that, or alongside that, I should say, is the potential that we have to operate in an environment in which they aren't secured. So we both have to be able to get those, eliminate those capabilities, and be ready to operate in the case that somebody has used them. The second thing is, in any kind of North Korea collapse scenario, the people who want to be stabilizing North Korea very strongly are the Republic of Korea. They believe that that, as Koreans, is their mission and role, and that UN operation would be, if you will, in support of the Republic of Korea. One of the challenges we've long had is trying to understand, I believe, is trying to understand exactly how well prepared they are for that local governance, if you will, capability. And it makes sense for that to be Koreans doing that job. So that's a tricky space because that's not an area where they have traditionally been really interested in our viewpoint about their capacity to do that. But I think that's should be a hefty diplomatic push now to try to make sure that they have those capabilities to understand where there might be gaps and how we can be helpful in that. I think those would sort of top it. On the U.S. military posturing side, I guess I would say, I think one of our big concerns always is the capacity of follow-on forces, particularly if it's not a gentle collapse. If that revolutionary coup sort of takeover also involves any sort of military operation moving south, as opposed to, don't worry, that, you know, we've got it from here and we're ready to happily unify. One of the big concerns is, what is that follow-on flow of force capability? And that gets into a variety of issues relating to lift, the posturing of capabilities on Korea. That's the third area I would look at.
Yeah, the only thing I'd add to that, I agree with the priorities and everything else, is the relationship with China. China wants a divided peninsula, and so the circumstances of how the North Korean regime changed or state collapsed or whatever would matter enormously. But whether China intervened or was worried about refugee flows going into China, you know, that would be a critical element policymakers would worry about.
I just want to jump on you're absolutely right to mention that. And the dynamic between China and North Korea really is changing. So if I'm looking 3 years out, I'm also trying to think about essentially exploiting that change. I think there's more ability to work with the Chinese today than there was, say, 3 years ago on planning together. But it's an area they've traditionally not wanted to talk to the U.S. about exactly what would happen in that kind of a hypothetical case and how we would operate around each other. But I think there's more opening now than there has been on that.
I would keep it it's a UN operation now, and I would keep it a UN operation. This brings the international community into it. It involves China as a member of the Security Council. It forces them to agree on the way ahead. It's hard, but all the best things in international politics are hard. And the goal should be a unitary Korea. It might actually, you know, we might even have to offer up that we'll remove forces from the peninsula to make that happen. And this, the international community, I know, it's,
no.
I said might. The international community can help here in a big way by surging humanitarian assets. And I agree with Kathleen that securing the nukes is job number one there.
Yeah, I agree with everything. This would be a UN operation under a South Korean lead. I think the United States absolutely will be the kind of number two player in terms of troops and money. I think the only thing that I would add to all this is that we would need to go in with wartime rules of engagement. I think we absolutely must expect that the North Korean special forces, I think it's the Security and Intelligence Directorate, we should expect that they will have studied the Iraqi insurgency, the Afghan insurgency, and we should expect them to do much the same thing. No matter how they collapse, no matter what the conditions are, there's going to be some diehards. There absolutely will. The terrain in Korea is unfortunately quite a lot like Afghanistan. So we should expect and therefore write the rules of engagement to meet that contingency. And if we do that and devote the amount of force with the right rules of engagement, that's the best chance we have of actually preventing an insurgency from breaking out.
Great. Sure. And then we'll come around this way. So we've got a microphone in the middle at all, right there back in the back of the middle.
Yes, this year marks the 40th anniversary of the collapse of South Vietnam and the collapse of the American effort at that country, which was led to the most embarrassing military performance in military history, with the exception, of course, of the recent collapse of the Iraqi army last year. Now, to the best of my knowledge, there's never been any sort of post-war study of why the United States failed in constructing the ARVN and why it's failed in the construction of a functioning South Vietnamese government or in other governments in Southeast Asia. And I'd like to know why no such studies are being undertaken currently, or correct me if there are, as to why we have failed so badly in Iraq and Afghanistan. It seems to me that one of those poke-in-the-eye obvious sort of things that we should be looking at, and our failure to do so does seem to indicate some sort of gross intellectual and moral failure of the national security establishment, particularly when we're setting ourselves up to fail for an equivalent military catastrophe in Afghanistan, where we've got an army that simply cannot be supported by the country's economy that will fail when it is attacked or forced to do any sort of serious military actions. Your comments.
Yeah, so, you know, we made a lot of mistakes in Vietnam, but, you know, that other war from 68 to 73 under General Abrams, been a lot of scholarship on that recently. You know, the ARVN actually fought pretty well in the Easter Offensive in 72. Now, they had U.S. air power behind them. They only collapsed when the U.S. cut off all aid and air power. Now, maybe they should have been able to hold their own against air power, but it was a North Vietnamese invasion that conquered South Vietnam at the end of the day, not a bunch of guerrillas. So.
Yeah, I completely agree there. I think it's inaccurate to say that the United States has comprehensively failed equally in every case that we've tried to build a foreign army, foreign security force partner. We have had pockets of success here and there, even in Vietnam, even in Iraq, even in Afghanistan. The units actually are capable of independent operations at lower echelons. What the United States is able to bring to the table are, again, logistics, intelligence, airlift, and air support. I think, Mick, you're absolutely right. That's the kind of the key variable. If you're a soldier out in the field and you know that you have air cover, it gives you a lot of courage and gives you a lot of morale, makes you more willing to fight because you know that the best air force in world history is above you. But when that air cover is pulled, as it was in Vietnam, as it was in Iraq, and as it was in Kunduz in Afghanistan just a month ago, that's when the soldiers rightly fear for their lives. So if we want to be successful in building these foreign security partners, we have to understand that there should be a long-term commitment in these key capabilities. It doesn't require 100,000 troops, but it does require some money and some key capability gaps like air cover.
We sometimes fall into the trap of assuming it's all about us, that there's something we could have done that could have made the ARVN better or the Afghan army better. I'll just use the case of the Iraqi army since I know that best. We left a fairly capable force in place with reasonable commanders, and they were a mixture of Sunni and Shia and Kurds. But when we left Iraq to the tender mercies of Nouri al-Maliki, he replaced most of the commanders that were tainted by their involvement with the United States with his own political hacks. And what do these commanders do? They're given a pot of money to train their division and to pay the soldiers and so forth. They pocket probably three quarters of it into their personal bank accounts. They don't pay the soldiers much. They don't train them at all. And then they expect them to fight. Actually, they don't expect them to fight. When ISIS came across the border, they simply decamped for Baghdad. Without leadership, the soldiers just turn over their arms and dissolve. So this is the only way we could have prevented this from happening was better political decisions in 2010 and 2011 in who we supported after the presidential elections of 2010, and then in keeping U.S. forces on the ground where they could partner with and oversee the Iraqi security forces and basically demarche the Iraqi government when they were reducing the capability of their forces by turning them into to regime security, basically a personal security detachment for the Prime Minister of Iraq.
Hi, I'm Jody Rosenstein. I'm a second-year PhD student here at LBJ, and I also was a USAID officer in Afghanistan, 5 years as a stabilization officer in the East, embedded in eastern Afghanistan. And my question is building along the similar lines here. If we were to go into a stability operation tomorrow, my question is, how much has been made into doctrine on what to do at the tactical level as CivMil and the interagency work together? In terms of things of, we always said in the field a lot is personality-based, and it really shouldn't be so, and certainly not after 12 years of working together should it still be personality-based. It took until 2010 for our interagency to even have, not even just CivMil, fusion cells to share intel. We never got on the same message in terms of strategic communications. We don't have a strategic communications cell sitting up at ISAF, for example. Or in terms of, just to pick one of the lines of development or governance, four different agencies, four different lines of operations for rule of law, DOJ, DOD, DOS, USAID, without a comprehensive strategy. So my question is, with all these lessons learned, how much has actually made it into our standard operating procedures?
I will say I don't know. I don't know the answer to that question. You've cited all the correct work that has or hasn't been done, but we are not even you know, we're not really executing, particularly since the end of Iraq in 2010, we're not executing day-to-day at that tactical level in a way that gives me confidence that that's, you know, even if the doctrine is there, that we are, you know, that we're on top of that. I think the question is that reflex function, because you said if we started tomorrow, as I said, you know, there's a little bit of ability, I suppose, to say that we're resting on our laurels and that we can, that reflex kicks in on both sides, the civilian and the military. But that's not, you know, that's a very much hope is a strategy approach. So I'm not confident.
Yeah, and you would like these things to be institutionalized, but as you said, a lot of it is personality department, and the real expertise is really in the people that work together. I mean, that's, doctrine will always lag that in terms of, you know, what institutions will write down. And so if those people are preserved and nurtured, and we'll probably be using them again, you'll have your best chance of success because they'll learn from what worked and what didn't. But, you know, it's certainly been my experience in the government. People matter way more than...
I would agree with that. But I do know the State Department created an organization called the Center for Complex Operations. The U.S. Army has its Center for Lessons Learned, and all of these organizations were meant to write down things and get it into doctrine. I just think the impetus is gone, right? As soon as we said we're not going to size the forces for prolonged stability operations, and we went off to different things, the military's back to, you know, figuring out how to fight China and Russia. You know, there's just no wind behind the sails, and you're right. I think a lot of this is gonna, it'll be stored in the archives and on dusty shelves, and then we'll pull it off again 30 years from now, or 20 or 5 years, or who knows when we do this again.
Yeah, I'm not optimistic that much is being captured at the tactical level. I think everything is always relationship dependent. My own effort to capture the lessons of the past is on Amazon.com.
Yours for only.
That's right. That's right.
I see some questions here, sir.
It seems like there's a. I'm hearing a. And I'm a layman here, and although I have been to the Middle East on a couple of occasions, Turkey and Jordan and the UAE and so forth, for work we'll call it, and the underlying denominator I keep hearing here of all our errors and mistakes and going into Mexico and we're having a counterinsurgency and we go into Iraq and we got a counterinsurgency and Afghanistan and so forth. It seems like by the time our stability of operations or our people that go in to stabilize the area is a symptom that has already been screwed up by the time you guys get there. We've screwed up somewhere along the way. On our political systems, looked like we were trying to fix the world in one administration time frame so we can get reelected. So and that's kind of concerning to me. And I applaud for the people in our agencies and so forth that are trying to put Humpty Dumpty together again, because it's a daunting task. When I was in Jordan in 2005, I was out in the middle of the almost to the Iraqi border, and we were talking to a group, and the gentleman tells me, we're talking about the political issues that are going on over there, and the gentleman says, my friend Gus, he says, look around you. He says, we've been doing this for over 2,000 years. He goes back to the Ottoman and to all these people that have come in to invade the area, the British and the French and so forth, and then he says, and now, my friend, you Americans are here. You too will leave. So you have all the power. You have all the know-how. You go around the world telling people what to do. We don't mind you telling us what to do. By that time, he's pointing at me. His hand is doing this. Now. We don't mind you telling us what to do. But you keep changing your mind every 4 years. So I thanked him for the tea and I walked away. We really are having to think ahead here when we're going into these messes, way ahead, because we're going into a farmer. By the way, this is a story. I'm from Uvalde, just west of here. They grow corn and milo and cotton and vegetables and so forth. There's an old farmer told me, he says, you know why we're getting in trouble in all these countries? He says, we've been telling the Smiths here for five generations they've been growing corn. And then this city slicker comes in and tells him he's got to plant cotton. And all they know how to do is plant corn. The mama knows how to bake cornbread, and he goes on up the whole generation. The kid knows how to run the tractor and so forth. These guys are coming in here telling him how to plant cotton now. So they force him to plant cotton. Although for generations, that's all they've been doing is planting corn. So they force him to change to plant cotton. But the cotton doesn't grow because the cotton, the people they're working don't know how to plant, how to grow corn. He says they forgot to tell him how to grow the cotton. The worst thing of it all, they came in to tell him to plant cotton, but the soil doesn't support cotton. We have to go in there and know how to tilt that soil in order to be able to plant cotton, guys. Otherwise, we're going to be going in through these same issues that you repeat over and over and over and over again. I failed this and failed that. You go in, we fail. We don't go in, it still fails. It takes a long time, and I don't know that we in the American society have the resolve, the time, to spend, to want to train these people how to work in a democratic society. They've always had a head guy telling them what to do. Then we go in, cut the head off, and we say, now you can do it by yourself. These guys don't know how to plant cotton. Thank you.
This will be the end here. I can whatever you like.
Go ahead.
Okay. So I think, you know, this gets to the very broad question of how we think about preventative diplomacy. And in probably 2008 or so, I was up on Capitol Hill doing a briefing for some members of Congress, and it was actually a Democratic and even left-leaning Democratic member of Congress who, in the course of this discussion we were having essentially on stability operations and building civilian capacity, said something to the effect of, I don't know how to sell preventative diplomacy. How do I go back to my district and say, this is why we're spending money, U.S. taxpayer dollars, on preventative diplomacy? And that's a long-standing problem that the United States has, and I think this set of issues falls into that. These approaches, Jordan is a perfect example. This is a generational challenge to help Jordan. It's immediately relevant. I think there is a decent amount of focus in the U.S. government on it, particularly, I think, obviously I'm a little biased, but particularly DOD, I think, has been pretty focused on helping the Jordanians. We see ahead to this whole generation of children growing up, not just in refugee camps, but the vast majority of them, the Syrians who are in Jordan, are growing up inside Jordanian society. They can't get jobs. They're in some cases shunned. There's huge mental health problems. There's health problems. And this small country that has almost no natural resources to rely upon, very poor, and already has its own internal dynamics that make it very difficult to govern, is straining. And that's just today. But you look ahead to what will grow as a challenge. You know, I was up at a refugee camp, for instance, on the Jordanian-Iraqi border about 6 months ago, and the UNHCR folks there were saying, you know, their planning factor generally with camps like that is 10 years. You know, you don't, that population, if you solved Syria tomorrow, 10 years before those people move back, fast forward this issue to Europe. These are huge challenges that we face, but how do you go as a U.S. government, if you will, as the technocrats, go forward to try to explain how we're going to tackle these as part of a multinational effort to build capacity in other countries when we have challenges here at home that compete for that and where it's very hard to measure success. So I don't, that is all to say, I do not think there is in any way an easy answer to that question. The United States spends 1% of its federal budget on foreign aid. It is a lot of money because the United States has a lot of money in its federal budget, but it is a very small percent of what we do. And even if we spent more, back to the point Mike and I were making before, you have to spend it well, and it's not really clear that we have set in institutions and processes that do that well. On top of that, you have incentives, as we saw played out time and again in Iraq in particular, where you have annual appropriated money, and you have, whether it's USAID or DOD, spending money to try to show short-term effects. And that's where you get these, you know, dig a well because you can dig a well. Did they need a well? Who knows? Build a school because you can build a school. Did they need a school? Who knows? You have these incentives that are not taking into account these long-term generational outcomes that you're aiming for. And it is kind of a mess. So I think there needs to be changes in how we as a society and then how we get our elected officials to think about national security in this broader sense of how we build capacity over time so we don't end up with large-scale operations on the back end involving the military to solve problems because we haven't invested at the front end.
Three responses. One, I agree there is an adverse selection effect in stability operations. By definition, if a place requires an intervention, it's already a hard place. If a place doesn't require an intervention, we wouldn't go there. You know? By definition, if we end up intervening somewhere, it means something had to have gone wrong in the world somewhere at some point, whether in that country or in our preventative diplomacy. You know, somebody's failed. So that means all stability operations kind of start off with a disadvantage, and they're very hard. That's why the success rate is barely above half. Second, you're absolutely right. Growing cotton, local knowledge is essential for success. It's kind of what I was getting at when I talked about tailoring an intervention to meet the conditions on the ground. I think subject matter experts, local experts, are indispensable for these kinds of things. One of the reasons why the political process in Afghanistan actually did go pretty well is because we had Zal Khalilzad in Afghanistan. He knew the players, he spoke the language, he was born in the country, and he was able to work with the key power brokers in the early years to shepherd that process along. Lots of other stuff in Afghanistan went badly, but that political process went surprisingly well. And I think the presence of an American diplomat with local knowledge was really meaningful. Third response, you talked about how the Ottomans ruled, the British ruled, and now the Americans are there. I'm a little bit wary of analogizing to imperialism. You hear this a lot in criticisms of the United States or Europe that we're just, it's the latest iteration of empire. There are differences between stability operations for the sake of liberal order and empire. We're gonna leave. Everybody knows we're gonna leave, and I'm proud of that. As you said, your friend knows the United States will leave. That's what makes us different from the past empires. Everyone knows we're gonna go. If anything, maybe we need a little bit more staying power. Perhaps we need a little bit more patience in these kind of interventions. But no one doubts that we're going to leave, or if we stay with the consent of the government, like in Germany, like in Japan. They've welcomed our ongoing presence there. If you insist on calling the United States an empire, you know, it's a different kind of empire. And if stability operations are a tool for fostering the inclusion of developing countries into liberal order, then it's a good tool of statescraft.
That is a perfect way to end our panel for today. Let's thank our panelists for their comments. Great start to day two. We'll see you back at 10:15.
Likewise.
Yeah.
Likewise.